Okay, hi everyone. So we'll start with amendments of constitution today.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon. Okay, so today we'll start with amendments of constitution and also look at some of the questions that Mansi shared. So some of those questions we will look, and also there are few more questions in that sheet only. So that part we will discuss in next class. So there are these like 4 or 5 questions that we will see today, and also amendments part.
Okay, ma'am.
So with regard to amendments, so amendment of Indian constitution, there are two different things that we see. Obviously, we know amendment is mentioned under article 368 of constitution part 20. So this is the main provision with regard to amendment of Indian constitution that we need to know, that it is article 368 that makes the provision, and it is under part 20 of constitution. But what happens is that while studying like different parts of constitution, different provisions, what we have seen is that there were other provisions also, right, where it was just mentioned that parliament can make this particular change if they want to, parliament can pass a legislation with this regard and then accordingly make a change with regard to this. So that means what, there are some other provisions where we don't need to follow the amendment procedure that is mentioned under article 368, but we can still make changes to it. So because of which we have divided it in like two parts. First is obviously article 368, the main amendment provisions, and also there are some other provisions where parliament can make some changes, but it is not under article 368. So these changes are not considered as amendment as per article 368, but this is also like parliament is making some changes based on the powers given to them under constitution only. So this is some other provisions, and this is article 368. So under other provisions, we have one type of like amendment only. This is the one process by which parliament can make some changes, and it is applicable to some specific like article specific provisions only, where we need special majority. And in case of article 368, it mentions two different like procedures, two different provisions for different types of articles. What are these two different types? One is by special majority, and another one is by special majority plus ratification from states. So this is why we say that the procedure for amendment of constitution is both like rigid and flexible. Why is it so? Is that we are not following, or we are not like sticking to one type of amendment process only. Because some parts of the constitution, what happens is that maybe we would need to make changes to those parts in the coming days, and we don't want to follow like a very rigid process that it becomes very difficult to make those necessary changes. So there are some provisions where we are simply like giving power to parliament, that parliament can make those changes. And process is also very simple. Why? Because maybe these changes are needed, or you know, like we will need those changes in one point of time or the other. So these are like very simple ways to make changes. And again, some are like moderate one, where we need like, it is like a little difficult, but it's not that tough also. And for some other provisions, what happens is that it is very difficult to make those changes. That means like people cannot just keep on making changes whenever or wherever they want to, but obviously it will have, it needs a very rigid process to make those changes. So based on the type of provisions or based on the type of article, there are like three different procedures that we follow regarding amendment. And this is the main reason why we say that we have like a mixture of both rigidity and flexibility when it comes to amendment. Some provisions we can make changes very easily. Some provisions we can make changes by following special majority. And for some other, it's like a little more difficult when it comes to making changes to those provisions. So these are the three different things that we have with regard to amendment. One is other general provisions where the article specifically would say that for this particular purpose, Parliament is having this power that it can make changes. For the amendment, Article 368, it is specifically saying that this is how the amendment should be made for these like specific articles. So these are the three things that we have. So with regard to amendment, under Article 368, we have two different procedures. One is by simple majority of Parliament. Another is by special majority of Parliament. Another is special majority of Parliament, along with that ratification by half of total number of states in India.
Ma'am, can you say that again? Sorry.
Yeah. So for Article 368, we have like two different parts, right? One is that we need special majority of Parliament. Another is we need special majority of Parliament. Plus, we also need ratification by half of total number of states in India. Then only that particular like bill would become an act and we can make those changes. So these are the three different things that we have, and different like articles or different provisions would come under this. So we will see what all things are there. Now, for some articles, what happens is that, take for example, like there are some changes that needs to be done with regard to like establishment of a new state, maybe with regard to changing of like territorial boundaries of a particular state, some kind of alterations with regard to areas of a particular state, or we want to make some changes regarding the privileges or allowances of president, governor, etc. So in such cases, what we have seen is that those changes can be made by passing an act of parliament. So in those cases, we need special majority of parliament only in order to make those changes. So what is special majority?
Two-thirds.
Special is?
Two-thirds.
No. Yeah, and simple is?
More than 50%.
Is it one-third?
Special is two-thirds, simple is more than 50% of the total members. So in such cases, what happens is that they can simply make simply pass a legislation and make those changes if they want to make some changes. For example, when we were discussing regarding president, vice president, president, governor, etc., what we have seen is that their salaries, their allowances, and all of that are mentioned under constitution itself, right? But they have said that these can be made, like these, there can be changes made by parliament. So those changes may be made by following the process of simple majority only. If they want to establish a new state, they want to change like quorum in parliament also, we saw, right? That we need like 1/10 of the total members to be present to carry forward any kind of meetings or any process in the parliament. So that minimum number of members that we need for functioning of parliament, that is also mentioned under constitution, but it was also said that that particular like quorum can be changed later on. So it can be changed from 1/10, it can be changed by the parliament. How they will change it, it also will be by following simple majority only. They can make those changes in quorum also. Then there can be changes with regard to like salaries and allowances of members of parliament also. They can make changes. When we were discussing citizenship, that time also we saw regarding acquisition and termination of citizenship. So parliament is just giving us like rough provisions. What would be the provisions regarding citizenship when constitution came into force? But later on, whatever changes are being made, whatever things they want to do, that can be made by parliament. So those things also would come under simple majority only, that this particular article itself is giving power to parliament that they can make those changes with regard to that. So for that, they don't need to follow like a very rigid thing. For this purpose, they can also make changes in terms of jurisdiction of Supreme Court. So we saw that criminal jurisdiction of Supreme Court was extended by a legislation. how these things are done is that we don't need to follow the rigid process. If they want that these particular changes should be made, so the article itself is mentioning that Parliament can make those changes by following simple majority, and accordingly the changes can be made to the constitution. So these are not coming under Article 368. So these we do not consider as amendment under Article 368, but obviously they are also making some changes to the constitution only. If constitution is saying that under like second schedule this provision is given, but Parliament is making some changes to it. So obviously it is some changes made to constitution only, but we do not consider it as an amendment of constitution under Article 368. So these are the few things that comes under simple majority. So you can just go through this list that this is regarding admission or establishment of new states under part one, formation of new states, alteration of its areas or changing name or any other things, abolition or creation of legislative councils in states. So last few classes we saw, right, that if there is a legislative council in any particular state and that state feels that they don't need that legislative council anymore, they can make or pass a resolution to for Parliament's approval, and accordingly it may be abolished. If they do not have a legislative council, they want to create one, then also they would request Parliament. So those things, we need simple majority only. Allowances, privileges of president, governor, etc. For these also, there may be specific legislations that Parliament will pass. Quorum of Parliament also, it is mentioned under Constitution, but again, it gives power to Parliament to make changes to it whenever they feel that it is needed. Similarly, jurisdiction of Supreme Court also, we can make some changes, citizenship and all of these things, we can make changes by simple majority of Parliament only. So for this, what happens is that when we are reading the Constitution, we would get different articles where it is clearly mentioned that for this, Parliament can make the changes accordingly by passing a law. So those are the other provisions that we have. So for these, we need simple majority of the Parliament, and for the remaining ones we need under Article 368, it is part 20 of the Constitution. So for this there are two different ways, by special majority and also by special majority plus ratification by states. So there can be certain types of like changes or certain types of amendments which are made by following special majority of Parliament. So special majority means like more than 50% of total members of each house should accept it, and also 2/3 of members in each house present in voting. So they should also vote in favor of that particular bill that they want to make changes. So in case of by special majority, we need, so it is applicable for most of the provisions. For this, you can see while reading the BARE Act, you would see different provisions. They have clearly mentioned that like Parliament can make those changes. So those provisions would come under this first category. And for the third category also, there are specifically like provisions are mentioned that for these things, we need ratification from states. So whatever is not coming under the first or third category, all of that would come under the second one, where we need special majority of Parliament. So what is special majority of Parliament? It is majority that is more than 50% of total membership of each house have accepted that particular bill, and majority of 2/3 members of each house have voted in favor of that particular bill. Only in that particular case it can become an act. So this is with regard to special majority. So total membership of house, when we say, right, that more than 50% of total membership of house, it means total number of members that this particular house is having. Maybe some members were not present on that particular day or something. Even then we need 50% of total membership of that particular house only. Then only it would be accepted. Otherwise they cannot say that, okay, like 50 members are absent on this particular date. On this particular day, so out of that only we would be counting. It's not like that. The total membership only, not how many are present. And in case of the other one, it is 2/3 of the members of each house who are present and who are voting. So these would be applicable for most of the other provisions where the article itself is not mentioning how it will be amended. Like for a certain article, if the article itself is not mentioning that Parliament can make that particular change, those also would come under this second part only.
So for special majority, you need 50% and 2/3 majority.
Yeah, so 50% of total members of that particular house. If it is like 500, it should be 50% of total members who should accept it. And also majority of 2/3 of members should like vote in favor of that particular bill. If it is like 200 members are voting, then more than like 101 or more than that should vote in favor of that particular bill. So these would be applicable for other general things, and there are like majority of parts where this provision would be applicable, like fundamental rights, DPSPs, or any other provision that is not coming under these two parts, their special majority only would be applicable. So for special majority, we need more than 50% of total membership of each house. They should accept it. 50% means total number of members in that particular house. It does not matter whether few members are absent on that particular day or whatever the case may be. It would be total membership of the house. And majority of 2/3 members of the house are present and voting. They are voting in favor of that particular bill. So this is coming under Article 368 only. This is the first type of amendment that we can make. And second one is by special majority of Parliament and also consent of states. So sometimes what happens is that we will also need consent of the states to make those changes. So these provisions of constitution which relate to federal structure of the polity. So take for example, there are some provisions under constitution that would affect the states also if a change is made. So in such cases, Parliament cannot just take a decision at their own wish and then they can make those changes because it would be affecting the states also. So in such cases, this third provision would be applicable. They would need special majority. So special majority is this provision only. And after it is passed from both the houses of Parliament, it will also go to the states for their approval also. If more than 50% of states are accepting it, then only it can become an act from a bill. So for these provisions, there are some like provisions under constitution that would affect the federal structure of Indian constitution. And for those, only Parliament is not like having the ultimate power that whatever changes they want, they can just bring those changes. Also, states should accept those changes. So for that, they would again need special majority of Parliament. And once it is approved from Parliament, it will go to the state legislatures and they should approve it by simple majority. So only in such cases, those changes can be made in the constitution. So these are the things that comes under it. Election of president and its manner, how election would be conducted, extent of executive powers of union and the states, Supreme Court and High Court, for example, regarding appointment of judges and all, if they want to make some changes, distribution of legislative powers between union and state, to which all things state would be having power to make laws and for what all things the union would be having power to make laws. Then any list in the seventh schedule, representation of states in parliament, power of parliament to amend the constitution, and its procedure. So even for Article 368 also, if they want to make some changes, even for that also, this like rigid type of amendment only is been followed. So for that also, they would need approval from...
Ma'am, but why any list in the 7th schedule? Because 7th schedule has like union list. But like, why does the consent of the states matter in matters of the union list?
Yeah, this is also with regard to like allocation of powers, like how powers would be divided between union and states only, right? So in whatever cases, like states are being affected in those also, it would be like applicable. So wherever like union, if for example there are like some powers given to states and union wants to take over like some powers from the states, that these matters union only would decide, union only would make laws, union only would pass regulations. So those cases also, maybe decision of parliament may be biased towards union. So what happens is that we need ratification from more than 50% of these states also. So take for example, any particular bill has been approved by parliament and then it goes to the states for their approval. So even if like some states are not taking any action or anything on that particular bill and more than 50% of the states accepts it, then also it will become an act. And also like there is no time limit given that within this time only they should approve it. So if once it is approved by more than 50% of states, it will become a law. So these are the things that are mentioned under the third type of amendment or the rigid variety of amendment, where it is a little difficult to make those changes. And for the other one, for the first one, you would see in different provisions of constitution only, it is specifically mentioned. For example, if you see the like allowances and privileges of president, you would see it's clearly mentioned in the article itself that parliament can make changes, parliament can pass a law and make the changes. If you see regarding citizenship also, parliament has been given power that parliament can make a law that would specifically mention regarding acquisition and termination of citizenship. So like that, these may be like specific provisions where they specifically given the power to parliament. So anything which is not coming under the first or the third category, for that we will follow the second way of amendment, that is special majority of parliament only we would need for that. So this is the list that you can refer for this like three things. So if a question comes regarding amendment of the Indian constitution, so you can mention that it is article 368 part 20 only that is talking about amendment. And also you can mention that for some other provisions under constitution, they have like not specifically mentioned regarding it, but the article itself says that this is how changes can be made to the article. So for those, parliament would be having power and it is not considered as an amendment under article 368. And for article 368, we have two ways. And why we are having different ways, just to ensure that there are like, not like parliament is making changes every now and then, whatever changes they want to bring. So those also should be like something which we need, or some genuine changes only. So we are having like different ways of making changes to the constitution based on the provisions. So process of amending the constitution is mentioned under article 368 of constitution, and it can be introduced in either house of parliament. So there is no limitation that only Lok Sabha can introduce or Rajya Sabha can introduce. It can be introduced in either house of parliament, but obviously state legislatures are not being given this power to introduce any bill or make any changes. But what they can do is that if anything is affecting federal structure of constitution and this mentioned for that we need ratification of states, only in that case states would have a say. But it is only that more than 50% of the states should accept it, then only it will become an act. So state legislatures are not having the power to like introduce a bill or anything like that. But it is Union Parliament only. It is Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. Both the houses are having same power with regard to introduction of a bill. And same it is, again, private members also can introduce and ministers can also introduce. We don't have any limitation on that. And we don't need prior like approval or recommendation of the president also. Just like how we saw in case of money bill, we would need recommendation or permission of president. But in case of constitutional amendment bill, we do not need permission of president. And it can be introduced by either ministers also or by private members of parliament also. So bill must be passed by each house by a special majority, that is majority of more than 50% of total members of that particular house and a majority of 2/3 of members of the house present in voting. So 2/3 or more than that should accept or vote in favor of that particular bill, and it should be accepted by more than 50% of the total membership of the house. Each house will pass the bill separately. There is no provision for like joint sitting or anything in case they are disapproving on that particular bill or they are not able to come to like one point or one thing, then also there is no like provision for joint sitting of the house. Both the houses should accept it or pass it separately only. So in case of disagreement between two houses also, there is no provision for joint sitting of the houses. And if it is with regard to federal provisions of constitution, then we need ratification of states only, states also. So ratification of states is by simple majority.
Ma'am, can you please explain that thing? Each house must pass the bill separately.
So in case of like ordinary bill, so we discussed that part. In case of like union legislature, what happens is that we have like different types of bills, right? When a bill is been passed, what happens is that, take for example, Lok Sabha is introducing a bill. Lok Sabha has passed it, they have approved it and everything. But then it goes to Rajya Sabha, they are not accepting the bill. Maybe it is not passed from Rajya Sabha. So what can be done is that we can have a joint sitting of both the houses, where both the houses can sit together and decide on that particular bill, whether it should be introduced or not. What are the merits or demerits? Both the houses can sit together and decide accordingly so that they can come to a conclusion whether they need to accept it or they don't want to accept it. Or for example, like Rajya Sabha is not taking any action, an ordinary bill has been passed, like forwarded to them. They are not taking any action. In such cases, what happens in case of general like legislations, what happens is that we can have a joint sitting. So joint sitting is basically organized just to have like, if both the houses are not agreeing or coming to like one point, so in such cases only it is organized so that they can come to a conclusion whether to accept the bill or not to accept the bill. But that provision is not there in case of constitutional amendment. It should be like accepted separately only. Both the houses should accept it, only then it can become a law.
Okay, ma'am.
So once it is passed by both the houses of parliament and also ratified by state legislature, wherever it is needed, then it will go to president for his approval. And president cannot withhold his assent or return it for reconsideration, like how the president can do in case of ordinary bill. President can send it for reconsideration of the house, that whether the things that they have mentioned in the bill are proper or not, if these changes can be done or not. So for reconsideration, ordinary bills he can send, but he cannot send money bills also. He cannot send constitutional amendment bills also. And after president's approval is received, then it becomes a constitutional amendment act and it would become applicable accordingly. So these are some things like regarding scope of amendability. So these are some things which are been considered as a part of basic structure in various court decisions. So you can go through this particular list, what all things are been considered as basic structure based on different case judgments. And also these are some cases regarding like amendment of the Constitution of India. So the main question is like, what is the scope of amending power of parliament, whether they can make changes to all the provisions or not, whether that particular, you know, like amendment power, whether it can be judicially reviewed or not, and all of that. So these are the main questions for. So these are the main questions for like all of these cases that we have. So you can just go through these cases, what was held basically in this particular case and what changes were made in terms of amending power of the parliament. So the first case is Shankari Prasad versus Union of India. Basically in this particular case, first constitutional amendment was challenged that it is taking away the fundamental rights that are given to us under part 3 of the constitution. So after independence, what happened is that for like all the developmental activities and everything, we needed land, but we were not having that much of land. So parliament wanted to make some changes and they wanted to take those, you know, like land from the zamindars and all of them. And they wanted to start with all of those developmental works. So these were challenged that it is taking away our right under part 3 of the constitution. We have a right to property and this right has been taken away from us. So these were challenged in this different cases that we have. So in this case, what was held is that the power to amend constitution includes power to amend fundamental rights as well. Even though part 3 is giving us some like guaranteed rights, even then those also can be made, like we can make changes to that also, because Article 368 is applicable to entire constitution. So if one part of constitution can be amended, that means fundamental rights can also be amended. So the word law used under Article 13 Clause 2 includes ordinary laws and does not include constitutional amendment, which is made in exercise of constituent powers and not legislative powers. So courts have this power to judicially review any particular law, whether it is like violating any part of part 3 of the constitution or not. But what was said is that this is applicable only for like the general laws, but we cannot review constitutional amendments because this power is not like a legislative power, but this is like a constituent power. Constitution itself gives this power that they can make changes to any part of constitution. So if any changes are made by way of Article 368, we cannot review that thing under Article 13. That means we do not have power to judicially review any constitutional amendment because it is not a law. We just have this power to judicially review any particular legislation, laws, etc., which may be there applicable in India. For that only we can apply Article 13 of the Constitution to see if it's violated, if it violates Part 3 of Constitution. But we cannot like see the same for constitutional amendments. So next is Sajjan Singh case. Same again, those laws only that were inserted in 9th schedule. So again, same thing only was challenged that these things are not valid. So 17th constitutional amendment was challenged in this particular thing, and Supreme Court approved judgment of Shankari Prasad. Like same judgment only they upheld, and they said that power to amend constitution means parliament has power to amend any part of provision of the constitution, and judiciary is having like limited power of judicial review only. They cannot just review anything that is done by parliament, but it is only limited to legislations that are been passed by parliament to see if any particular legislation is violating part 3 of constitution or not. Only to that extent they are having judicial review. Next is Golaknath versus State of Punjab. In this case also again, the same issues only regarding land rights, whether the 17th constitutional amendment is valid or not. So Supreme Court overruled the majority judgment of Shankari Prasad and Sajjan Singh case. And what they said is that Parliament had no power to amend Part 3 of the constitution. So what they basically said is that Article 368 is not like giving you the power to make changes, but it is only mentioning the procedure to amend the constitution. So the heading of Article 368 previously, it was that like procedure to amend constitution. So it said that even though like Article 368 is mentioning regarding amendment of constitution, it is just mentioning the procedure. That does not mean you are being given with this power to make changes to the constitution and you can change whatever things you want to like change in the constitution. So fundamental rights are like out of reach of the parliament because these are like guaranteed rights. Already these rights are been given to us. And also Article 13 is there to protect anything that would violate Part 13. So an amendment is law within meaning of Article 13 Clause 2 also. And if any constitutional amendment violates fundamental rights, then it is void under Article 13. Basically, Article 13 was like given more power. It was said that Article 13 is there to protect our fundamental rights. In case anything is violating fundamental rights, then it would become like void only. So it would be applicable for laws also. It would be applicable for constitutional amendments also, whatever it may be. And Parliament is having like limited powers only. They cannot touch Part 3 of Constitution. So Article 13 are not source of protection, but are expression of reservation. So because Article 13 is there, it is like a reservation thing that these are the rights that we have and there cannot be any changes to these rights. And Parliament cannot make those changes. So fundamental rights can be amended only by a new constituent assembly, which might be converted to Parliament by enacting a law for that purpose. Because these rights are being given to us by a constituent assembly under the constitution, so Parliament is not having this power. So basically in this particular case, it was said that because we are like given this power to change any part of constitution, Article 368 is applicable to constitution, so it would also apply to fundamental rights. Whatever changes they want to make, they can make those changes. And under Article 13, judicial review is been given, but it is applicable only for the normal, like regular legislations only. We cannot apply the same to constitutional amendments. So same thing was also approved in this particular case also. So they said that amendment of constitution means Parliament has the power to amend any part of constitution, whether it's Part 3 or any part of constitution. Article 368 itself is giving Parliament this power. But Golaknath case said that Parliament has no power to touch Part 3 of constitution. And in general also, Article 368 is just talking about the procedure to amend constitution. It is not giving Parliament enough powers to make any changes, whatever they want to make. Then 24th Constitutional Amendment Act came. So this amendment was brought just in order to remove whatever restrictions were put by Golaknath case, that we cannot, touch Part 3 of the Constitution. These are whatever given under Constitution only. These changes can be made only by establishing a new Constituent Assembly. Otherwise, Parliament is not having these powers. Article 13 acts like a reservation. We cannot touch Part 3 of Constitution. So just in order to remove those like lot of restrictions that were put by Golaknath case, 24th Constitutional Amendment Act came. And it inserted Article 13 Clause F that provided that nothing in this part shall apply to amendment of constitution. That means Supreme Court and High Courts do not have the power to review any constitutional amendment act that has been passed. So basically whatever constitutional amendments are being passed, those would be valid, whether it is violating Part 3 or any part of constitution, those would be valid. And judicial review power was basically limited. And also under Article 368 also some changes were made. Initially it was only procedure for amendment of constitution. So this was the heading of Article 368. Because in Golaknath case it was said, right? In Golaknath case it was said that Article 368 is just mentioning the procedure. it is not giving you any powers to make changes. So what they did is that they made changes to the heading. They said that it will be power of parliament to amend the laws and procedure thereof. So they like made changes to Article 368 also, and they made it like Article 368 is basically giving parliament this power to make changes in it. And also they said that nothing under Article 13 will apply to Article 368. Courts will not have judicial review on any changes made under Article 368. Basically, judicial review will not apply to any constitutional amendment. So these are the changes that were made by the 24th constitutional amendments, just to remove the restrictions that were given by Golaknath case so that they can make changes accordingly. So during this period, what happened was that parliament had like unlimited powers. They can make changes to any provision, whatever changes they want, they can do that. And also courts will not have any say on any kind of amendments. They changed Article 13 also, they changed Article 368 also. Parliament was given unlimited power to make changes, and judicial review was restricted. It will not apply to amendment of constitution. Article 368 clause 3 was also inserted that judicial review will not apply to Article 368 of the constitution.
Ma'am, can you please again explain how Article 13 is relating here?
Okay, so see, because under Article 13 we discussed, right, that there are like, if any particular law is violating any part of constitution, we can held that as void, right? This part will no more be applicable until and unless there is a change. Doctrine of severability we discussed. Then what happens is that if, for example, under Article 368, that is what? Under Article 13, what we discussed is that for general laws, if there is any legislation which is violating provisions of constitution, it will no more be applicable. Basically, part 3 would be like applicable, and that particular legislation will not be applicable. But what if there is a change under Article 368? Like if any changes are made to constitution, take for example, we are having right to property. If parliament makes a change under Article 368 and it says that from tomorrow, right to property is not a fundamental right, it's not like a guaranteed right given to you. So in such cases, whether we can like challenge that particular constitutional amendment or not under Article 13, basically. So whether constitutional amendments can be challenged under Article 13 or not, whether courts can see if a constitutional amendment is violating Part 3 of Constitution or not, and accordingly declared it as unconstitutional. So this is how Article 13 is related, that Article 13 is there to protect Part 3 of Constitution, whatever fundamental rights have been given to us. But is it applicable only to the general laws, or is it applicable even to constitutional amendments? So parliament can make those changes, right? If under general laws they cannot make those changes, they can make changes to the constitution, and then they can accordingly take away any fundamental rights that they want to. So whether this is valid or not, so for that only Article 13 is coming here.
Okay, ma'am.
So by 24th constitutional amendment, parliament got like enough powers to do whatever they want to any part, any provision of constitution, and no one can question them. So again, Keshavananda Bharti versus State of Kerala, this case challenged 24th constitutional amendment. So this is also known as the fundamental rights case. So parliament has powers to amend the constitution, but the basic structure of constitution cannot be destroyed. So 41st then, basic structure doctrine was introduced in Keshavananda Bharti case, and they said that 24th constitutional amendment is not valid. Why? Because parliament is having power to amend constitution, but they cannot destroy the basic structure of constitution in name of amendment. So parliament is under an obligation to ensure that whatever is the basic structure or basic nature of constitution, that remains same, and after that they can make little here and there they can make changes. So this this provision was introduced in this particular case, and it was said that Parliament's power to amend constitution is limited. It's not unlimited as mentioned by the 24th constitutional amendment. So there are few things that were considered as basic structure in this particular case: secular character of the constitution, republic and democratic form of government, separation of power, federal structure of constitution, supremacy of constitution, sovereignty and integrity of India, democratic polity of our country. So these are few things that were considered as basic structure in Kesavananda Bharti case. And also it was said that this list is not like limited to only these grounds only. Court can include many other things also in coming in other cases also. So if a matter comes tomorrow, court feels that this also should be a basic structure, court can include that as well. So this concept was introduced, and it was said that Parliament can make changes, but it should not affect these provisions. Like, the basic nature of constitution cannot be changed by Parliament. Next is Indira Nehru Gandhi versus Raj Narayan. So this is again regarding the election of Indira Gandhi. So what happened is that it 39th Constitutional Amendment Act was challenged, which withdrew the jurisdiction of all courts over election disputes involving Prime Minister and Speaker. So basically, this matter went to Supreme Court also. So what happened was that her election, she was getting temporary stay with regard to election. So she knew that obviously this matter would be decided by courts with regard to election, any kind of corruption with regard to election. So what she did is that she changed the constitution itself. She made this 39 constitutional amendment saying that no court will have power to question with regard to Prime Minister or Speaker's election. So in this particular case, democracy and judicial review were held as basic structure. Basic structure of the constitution, and also it was said that Parliament has no power to violate them by way of any kind of constitutional amendment. So our 39th constitutional amendment, it cannot just make some changes that would affect democracy or judicial review. It cannot restrict power of courts also to see whether this particular thing is valid or not. These also were held as part of basic structure only. And these are few other things that were included in list of basic structure: rule of law, equality of status and opportunity, secularism, free and fair election, and judicial review. All of these were also inserted. That is 42nd Constitutional Amendment Act. What it did is that this again was introduced in order to remove the limitations that were inserted by Kesavananda Bharti case. It inserted clause 4 and 5 in Article 368 of the Constitution that says that there is no limitation upon the amending powers of Parliament under Article 368, and constitutional amendment will not be subject to judicial review under any ground. Basically, constitutional amendment will not be subject to judicial review under Article 13 of Constitution, and whatever changes have been made by the a constitutional amendment, there is no limitation on that. Whatever changes they want, Parliament can make those changes. We cannot restrict that this thing cannot be changed, this thing cannot be changed, but it is like an unlimited thing. So this is the 42nd Amendment Act that inserted these two provisions. Again, this was also challenged in Minerva Mills versus Union of India case, and it said that this is unconstitutional and invalid. This 42nd Amendment Act that said that Parliament is having unlimited powers, there is no, they do not need to follow basic structure rules or anything like that. They can make any changes, and also judiciary cannot question their decision. So this thing was considered as unconstitutional.
Ma'am, in this case, if I'm not wrong, something was discussed relating to changes in Article 31C also, ma'am.
31C also. This was like, this mail was taken over by government. So they wanted transfer of management. They wanted to take over this. So with regard to that, so many things were discussed with regard to amendment thing. It was basically the 42nd amendment. These two like clauses that were inserted by 42nd amendment, those were challenged. I have also put the link, I guess. Okay, I'll also put the link regarding facts of the case. There were many matters discussed regarding taking over charges of this mail by government. So that thing you can go through. And for amendment part, it is these two clauses that were challenged and said that Supreme Court reaffirmed doctrine of basic structure and judicial review. And it said that Parliament is having limited power with regard to amendment. And so basically what was held is that Parliament can make changes in the constitution, but also judiciary can also see whether those particular changes are valid or not, if it is violating any part of basic structure of the constitution or not. So these are all the like cases and everything. So all in all of these cases, the main question is, what is the like, is the power of Parliament to make changes in constitution unlimited? And what to what extent judiciary can review any constitutional amendment? So basically, judiciary can review constitutional amendments to see whether they are violating any part of basic structure or not, whether they are just trying to change any, you know, like the basic structure or basic nature of constitution or not. So judiciary can question that. So these are the few cases regarding amendments. So if a question comes with regard to amendment, you can mention two different things are there. Some articles only are specifying. We can make changes, like Parliament can make changes. For some, we have Article 368 Part 10 that is mentioning two different types of amendments. For simple majority, we have all these different provisions where the article specifically is saying giving Parliament this power. For special majority, any other thing which is not coming under the first or the third ground, those would come under special majority. And accordingly, changes can be made, like fundamental rights, DPSP, or any other thing that is not coming under it. And for the last one, special majority of Parliament and consent of state, whatever is affecting federal structure of Indian constitution or any of these things that are listed, for that, it would be like we would need ratification from half, more than half of the total states as well. So this is the process of amendment that just you can go through. You can maybe write it in a paragraph or so that this is how it can be done. Both the houses are having same powers. It can be introduced in either house, member, like private members or ministers having same powers only. They can introduce it. There is no concept of joint sitting and all of that thing you can mention. And regarding amendment, you can say that like the power of Parliament to amend the constitution, that has been challenged in many different cases, whether there is any limitation on that power and what is this limitation. So these are few cases that you can refer. That first cases, it was said that Parliament is having like power to make changes to anything, and constitutional amendments are not coming under Article 13. Judiciary cannot question constitutional amendment or cannot declare it like unconstitutional just because it is violating Part 3. If under Article 368, they can make changes in constitution, it would be applicable for any part of the constitution, including Part 3. In Goloknath, it was said that Article 368 is just mentioning the procedure to amend constitution. It is nowhere giving you power to amend constitution. And if you want to make changes in constitution at all, then we would need establishment of new constituent assembly. Parliament cannot just make any changes. And also Parliament cannot touch Part 3 of the constitution because it is like guaranteed rights to us. And also there is Article 13 that would protect or reserve those rights. If anything is violating Part 3, that would be declared as void under Article 13. So basically, in this case, like it was limited to a great extent.
I see Goloknath overruled Shankari Prasad and Sajjan Singh.
Yeah, it overruled both the two cases.
And then after 17th came the 24th, which was overruled in Keshavananda Bharati.
Yeah.
Right. And after 24th, it was the 39th.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. 42nd.
So again, for like removing these restrictions, 24th constitutional amendment came and it amended Article 13 also, Article 368 also. It basically said that court is not having powers and Article 13 would not apply to constitutional amendments.
But even if Keshavananda Bharati held 24th constitutional amendment as not valid, the provision of 368 still reads power to. Even today, the problem...
Yeah, it is there. But again, in case of like this Minerva Mills case, if you see, it was held that parliaments, like it is even in... If you read like Article 13 also, Article 368 also, you would see that parliament, you know, like courts are not having power to question any kind of changes. But courts can question changes made by like parliament with regard to any part of constitution on these grounds. Like, if it is violating any like basic structure of constitution or not. So basic structure still remains valid and judiciary has the power to question that this particular feature you are like changing completely by way of amendment of constitution. So if you read the article, you would see that provision, but basic structure thing is still applicable. On that ground, courts can like question it. So 24th is like Article 13 and Article 368, they made changes so that they can make changes in constitution under Article 368. And in Keshavananda Bharati again, 24th constitutional amendment was challenged and they said that basic structure cannot be changed. They included some things as basic structure and also said that this list is not like exhaustive. We can include new things in coming cases also. Then Indira Nehru Gandhi, again, few more things were inserted as a basic structure and also said that judicial review is also a basic structure of constitution and we cannot just put a restriction on judicial review. We cannot just say that it would be applicable only for ordinary laws and it will not be applicable for constitutional amendments. We cannot do that. Then 42nd constitutional amendment, again, it said that there is no restriction on power
the case
of
in which the 39th was challenged, Indira Gandhi versus Raj Narayan.
Okay. So after that, again, they made changes that there is no restriction on parliament's power and constitutional amendments are not subject to judicial review on any ground, whether it's basic structure or some other ground. But again, that was like in Minerva Mills case, they said that parliament is having power to make changes to constitution, but also judiciary can question any changes made by parliament on the ground of like these basic structures. Parliament cannot just make changes or any other thing. So basic structure doctrine was again like approved in this particular case also. And judicial review would be applicable because it also is a part of basic structure only. So we cannot make change. Like by way of an amendment, we cannot just say that court is not having power to question a constitutional amendment because judicial review in itself is a basic structure. So this basic structure theory is like even applied till date to see whether parliament is, you know, like exercising their jurisdiction more than what they have been given with, more power than what they have been given with under constitution. So again, even today, we can challenge constitutional amendments based on any of these grounds. So these cases, you can remember like a sequence. And these are some like important constitutional amendments. I have inserted 12. There are like few more, some like 20 or something I will give you. When I share this document, right, I will try to insert few more also, like around 20 or something we can have that you can go through for the important constitutional amendments. Also, like these are few things which we anyways discussed while discussing like different parts of constitution also, we have discussed these things so that you can go through. So this is the list mentioning all the things. So I will also insert regarding reservation for SC and ST. It was extended for 10 years. So that part I will insert regarding the constitutional amendment. So it basically mentions the number of Constitutional Amendment Act and also the year and mainly for what purpose it was been inserted. So that thing you can go through. Now with regard to the questions, so these are the different questions. Okay. So first question, what will be the answer? This is like a MCQ that was inserted along with the subjective ones. So this was for Punjab Judicial Service exam 2010. Which of the following union territories has a legislature?
Pondicherry.
And also which one has else that day we discussed, right?
Chandigarh also.
Chandigarh don't have, Delhi is having, and also for Jammu and Kashmir also, like the provision was made when it was made a union territory, the provision was made that they will be also having a legislature. So you can
But there was also a legislation that talks about that Daman and Diu and Dadra Nagar will have a single legislation. So is it not talking about that legislature, like how this question is asked, like, because others also have legislation, like if I'm not wrong, it was around 2018 or 2019 when there was a call from government side that there will be a legislation merger for Daman and Diu and Dadra Nagar Haveli.
Like under their Reorganization Act, is it?
Maybe, ma'am. I'm not very sure. But yes, they said that legislation will also be for that. And they were talking about joint legislature. So if this question is given, if I'm not wrong, I think the answer will be Dadra Nagar also and Pondicherry also. But I think the question...
And also it was like a very old question, right? 2010 question only. Can I just do legislative assembly? Yeah, it was that Reorganization Act only where it was like proposed. So this was like very old question. Maybe we can like remove this thing.
Yes, ma'am. Because when if we'll just see about the legislation of Union Territory, then among these options, like Delhi also has their legislature. Yeah. Pondicherry also has. So yeah, it's
Jammu and Kashmir also now would come.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. And then again, these are some of the questions. So few of those subjective questions we discussed like in two classes. So today we will discuss some and few more are there that we will see sometime later. So this question is regarding 2000 UP judiciary question from 2000. So it is saying discuss the power of president to proclaim emergency. What changes have been brought with this regard by the Constitution 44th Amendment. Okay, so if this part comes, right, which emergency would you write? If, for example, this thing comes, discuss the power of president to proclaim an emergency, which all types of emergencies would you write in your answer?
Presidential rule.
Okay.
352, I think.
Yeah, only we will mention 352 because when we were discussing emergency that time also I told, right? When they are saying proclamation of an emergency, it is Article 352 only that they are referring. If they are asking in general, what is the power of president to declare emergency in India or something like that, then maybe we can write about like three different things. But proclamation of emergency is applicable only for Article 352. So when a question comes, discuss the power of president to proclaim an emergency, they are specifically asking for Article 352 only. But take, for example, you are not clear whether they are asking for national emergency or all the three types. Then also it becomes clear when you read this thing that what changes are made by 44th Constitutional Amendment with regard to it. So 44th Constitutional Amendment we discussed, right? What all changes have been made with regard to this. So you can mention that it is with regard to national emergency only that they are asking. So now if they say power of president to proclaim an emergency, if only this part was there in the question, that while writing the question itself, you can include that this is what was there previously, but this are the changes that were made by 44th constitutional amendment, and write like that accordingly you can write. But they are asking specifically for 44th constitutional amendment also, like a separate part. So you can just in general write what is the situation for national emergency right now and what were the changes made by 44th constitutional amendment. So that part you can write as a separate part. So you can just mention, like, I have not framed the question answer properly, but I have just mentioned what all things you can write here. You can mention again part 18 only, from Germany they derived this idea of having emergency, and we are having it under part 18 of the constitution. So with regard to national emergency, you can also write that there are three different types of emergencies we are having, and article 352 is talking about national emergency. There are three grounds that are applicable: war, external aggression, and armed rebellion. It may be in India or it may be in any part of India also. So it's not like national emergency is declared, it should be in entire India. It may be declared in parts of India also, depending on it. So if 44th was not given as a separate part, maybe you can mention that war, external aggression, and armed rebellion, but initially it was like internal disturbances. 44th Constitutional Amendment Act made that change, and now these are the three grounds that are applicable for us. So how president can declare? He can proclaim emergency only after receiving written communication with that regard from Union Cabinet. Before 44th Amendment Act, written communication was not needed, or it may be just like Prime Minister is giving an advice and President is acting based on that. But now the procedure is little more changed by the 44th Constitutional Amendment. Then proclamation of emergency is issued by President under Article 352. It must be approved by both the Houses of Parliament with special majority. The moment it is proclaimed by President, it will also go to the Houses, like Parliament, for their approval. And if it is not approved by the Houses, then it will cease to like operate after 1 month. So till 1 month, it is like the initial validity. Even without approval from Parliament, it would be valid for 1 month. And Parliament can approve it for another 6 months period. And after 6 months, we would again need approval. So there is no maximum time limit for national emergency like we have for state emergency. So there is no maximum limit that has been given. They can take approval from Parliament from time to time for six months, and it can exist for like any period of time. And it can continue for indefinite period if the conditions or any other requirement that is needed are fulfilled. Article 352.
What is the time limit for a state emergency? 6 months.
It is 3 years. No, it is like 3 years ultimately they can give. It's like initial validity is like 2 months. Without approval, it can exist for 2 months. Then Parliament would approve it for like 6 months. Again, it can extend it for 6 months. And after that, like 1 year is completed, right? From 1 year to next 2 years, it cannot just approve it. Like Parliament cannot just approve it. There should be national emergency declared in some part of India or entire India. Or maybe the election commission of that particular state is saying that we are having problems in having an election in our like particular state. Only in that case it can be extended. So for state emergency, it is 3 years. But after 1 year, like other conditions would also apply. So it becomes a little more difficult to continue after 1 year. But validity is 3 years. Okay. And this is the initial validity. It is 1 month in case of national emergency. It can be extended for 6 months, and it can be extended again after 6 months, again extended. So there is no like defined time limit for it. So revocation of powers by Lok Sabha. So again, power has been given to President that any time without parliamentary approval, he can revoke national emergency. If President feels that maybe this emergency should not exist, President can revoke it. Also, this power has been given to Lok Sabha that they can also revoke it by passing a resolution that they disapprove continuance of this particular emergency. even though at one point of time they approve it, now they disapprove continuance of this national emergency. And this power is given only to Lok Sabha. Rajya Sabha is not having this power. Next is with regard to effect on fundamental rights. So Article 19, if emergency is because of war or external aggression, that is external emergency, then Article 19 will be automatically suspended. But in case it is because of internal, it is an internal emergency because of armed rebellion, then Article 19 will not be automatically suspended. And Article 20 and 21 cannot be suspended in any case. And President can suspend any other fundamental rights by issuing a proclamation. It may be the first proclamation only whereby he is declaring emergency, where he would mention that these fundamental rights will also be taken away from people. So like that also, fundamental rights may be taken away from people. So this is like effect in general. Union executive can give directions to state on how they should operate. Then parliament can make laws conferring powers or imposing duties, that this thing will be, you know, like looked after by this particular person or this designated person for this particular area. So like that, there may be certain like orders and all also given. State executive and legislature will function on the direction of parliament or union executive only. So how many times it's been declared? These are the three types with three different grounds: external aggression, war, and internal disturbance. And after this third emergency only, we had all these changes made just to ensure that emergency powers are no more like misused under Article 352. So it is not necessary for proclamation of national emergency. It is not necessary that external aggression or armed rebellion has actually happened, but it may be because the president feels that there is a possibility of happening some kind of external aggression or external aggression also. In that case also, it may be done. So ADM Jabalpur versus Shipkant Sukla, that any person who has been detained under any preventive detention laws, those persons do not have a right to file writ of habeas corpus or to question the reasons or grounds for their arrest. So all of these, like all these three different emergencies, when they were declared, lot of people were being arrested without any grounds, without any justification or anything like that, just saying that their activities or behavior are not like proper for India's security. So same happened in case of this case also. And also it was said that if a person has been arrested on any ground like that, like preventive detention, under any preventive detention laws, they do not have the like power to question their grounds for arrest also. They do not have power to consult a lawyer also, and all of that, right? They do not have. Also, this was another case where it was held that no judicial review or investigation regarding validity of any order made under Article 352 to deprive a person of personal liberty. And if a person has been arrested during this period under any preventive detention laws, the person, obviously, he cannot question grounds of arrest. He will not have a right to consult a lawyer and all of that. Also, he cannot even question the conditions of this particular prison or any other things also like that. So he cannot basically question any other things also, and he will have no rights. So this is another case. Then also in Minerva Mills case, it was held that there is no bar on judicial review of validity of proclamation of emergency. So with regard to validity of proclamation of emergency also, judiciary can review it. Basically, they can review whether like satisfaction of precedent was like a proper satisfaction, or it was like on some or the other ground they are declaring emergency. So basically, judiciary can also review those things. In case of Minerva Mills case, it was also inserted like a basic structure only. Judicial review was inserted like a basic structure, and judiciary can see whether the ground for declaration of emergency is proper or it is just some irrelevant grounds based on which they are declaring emergency.
What was held in ADM Jabalpur?
If any person has been arrested, because during this periods, right, when we had these three emergencies, a lot of people from opposition and whoever is going against government, they were arrested. So they cannot, whoever has been arrested, they cannot question their grounds of arrest. They cannot consult a lawyer. They cannot have a hearing or any other things. Basically, their rights are been taken away. They cannot even use the writ of habeas corpus also.
Okay.
So in this case, again, the ground of ground of review shall extend to review of proclamation under this say. So again, they said that judicial review can be exercised, but to what extent we can see is that we can see whether like the ground for declaration of emergency is proper or not. So President's proclamation invoking national emergency in war, external aggression or armed rebellion has been amended by judicial review on limited grounds. This include whether there was any material upon which the president based his satisfaction, whether president made malafide or whether power exercised was ultra vires. So basically courts would see whether president's satisfaction was proper or not. Is it based on some irrelevant grounds? Whether president received written communication or not, all of those things court can see and ensure that the declaration of emergency is based on proper grounds only. It is not like some or the other ground that they want to declare and they are doing it. So this cases also you can mention that as of now, what happens is that when emergency has been declared, courts can see whether the ground was proper or not and whether there was written communication or not and all of that. So procedure for proclamation of emergency, it can be made by president, but there are some provisions with regard to that also. President can declare it only when he receives written recommendation from Union Cabinet, and such proclamation needs to be approved by both the Houses of Parliament. And what happens is that otherwise it will be valid only for 1 month. After that, it will no more be valid. Then 44th Constitutional Amendment Act also they mentioned in a separate part. Constitutional Amendment also you can mention. So 44th Constitutional Amendment Act, it made some changes with regard to emergency provisions under Part 18 of the Constitution. And it can be declared only in case of war, external aggression and armed rebellion. Basically, it removed the word internal disturbance, because internal disturbances was like open to interpretations. Any and everything we can include as internal disturbance. So that term was changed and we have now armed rebellion. So these changes were made by the 44th Constitutional Amendment. And these are the other changes. So Article 20 and 21 cannot be suspended even during emergency. In all the previous emergencies, like all the three different emergencies that we have, what happened is that a lot of people were being arrested without having any rights or without having the authority to question their arrest. They were arrested. So now it is said that people cannot be arrested, like people will have these two rights. 20 and 21 cannot be suspended even when emergency is declared based on war, external aggression or armed rebellion or whatever the case may be. Internal disturbance was replaced with armed rebellion because internal disturbance is open to interpretation. Just to limit their powers, it was removed. President need written recommendation from Union Cabinet, and courts can also see whether that particular ground is proper or not based on which recommendation has been received. Initial validity is reduced to 1 year from two months. Previously, it was like 2 months, even in case of national emergency, that in case it is not approved by Lok Sabha, then also even in that case also we can do it. So special majority of parliament is needed for approval of any particular proclamation. Previously it was simple majority. Okay, so these questions, right, depending on the marks you need to like decide what all things you want to write in this particular like question. For example, this particular question, if it comes that discuss about like proclamation of emergency and the marks is like 5 marks, then whatever you can write, like depending on like how important that particular thing is, you can decide. Maybe you can write regarding the grounds for like national emergency article, you can mention what will be the effect on fundamental rights in general, And also you can mention maybe like 44th constitutional amendment, and also like important cases that this is where it was held, the judiciary is having power to see that ground for declaration of emergency is proper. So like that you can write. If it is for more marks, then maybe you can mention that these are the three times when emergency was declared, what all things went wrong during this period, what all things we learned, and how we made changes by way of 44th constitutional amendment. So like that you can write depending on the marks. If it's like for lesser marks, you can just mention that article 352, these are the grounds for declaration. President can proclaim emergency, but he would need approval from from parliament. So like that you can accordingly write. So this is what all things you can mention for this. So next is the fact that judiciary has a say with matters of amendment of the constitution. Okay, so this is regarding power of judiciary to, you know, like question amendment of constitution. So for this question is, so for that you can write like these cases, you can write that there is always a debate on parliament's power to make changes to the constitution. So definitely we would need changes in constitution, but obviously it should not be like a very simple process that every now and then they are making some changes. So that is why like different ways of amendment were been mentioned under the constitution. But later on what we have seen is that parliament is misusing their powers. They are just, you know, like widening their powers, restricting judicial review on any kind of constitutional amendments or like that. So you can give this particular like cases that these are the cases where it was said that parliament is having unlimited powers. Then again, parliament's power was like completely restricted. They cannot touch part three. No changes can be made to constitution. We would need a new constituent assembly to make changes. So obviously we would need to make changes in constitution in like depending on the situation. So it is also not proper that this process is like very much restricted that we would need a different constituent assembly only. So now we are having these amendments, these cases came. And now what is the situation is that judiciary is having power to question it. Basically, you can write this paragraph also that judiciary is using the basic structure doctrine to ensure that parliament is not like over exercising the power that are being given to them. And they can question any kind of constitutional amendments made by the parliament on the ground that it is violating basic structure of the constitution. So like that you can mention this for this particular question. Okay, next is under what conditions president can declare emergency. So for this, what all things would you write?
War. I mean, mention the 44th Amendment and 352.
Yeah. So for this, they are not specifically saying like what kind of emergency. So you can mention all the three different things. So you can mention there are three different types of emergencies under Part 18. National emergency, we can declare on three grounds: war, external aggression, and armed rebellion. State emergency, we can have based on like governor is sending a report to president or president is otherwise satisfied. There is also another provision, Article 365, regarding presidential rule that also would apply, that state is not following center's like orders or directions. Then we have financial emergency, and we are having two grounds, that financial stability of India or credit of India is threatened or any part of India has been threatened. So these are the three grounds that we have. So they are not mentioning what type of emergency. So three of them you can mention. If it is for lesser marks, you can just mention the grounds and articles. If it is for more marks, maybe you can mention the validity also. For national emergency, initially is 1 month. For other two, it is 2 months. They would need approval. What kind of approval? And all of those things you can mention. Next is so conditions for proclamation, right? Also, you can mention how it may be revoked, What are the situations? All of those things you can write for this particular question. Describe the procedure for amendment of constitution. Under what circumstances amendment requires ratification for legislature of state? Okay, so for this also you can mention, like, first of all, though, you can mention why amendment is needed. That thing you can mention, because like at one point of time constitution has been made depending on the that like prevailing situation. So it's not like situations would be same, society would be same. So we would definitely need some changes. So provisions are being made under constitution. Obviously, it was felt that some provisions we would need to change more frequently, maybe. So the process is simple. For some, it is rigid provisions are mentioned under Article 368. There are two different ways of like making changes. Then you can mention these other things where ratification by legislature of state is needed. So you can also mention whether this provision is good or bad for constitution. Like, we need ratification of states, whether that provision is like good for India or not. That thing also you can mention. Maybe you can mention that. It also like ensures that parliament is not just making changes in matters that would affect states also. Parliament is not just like widening their powers and limiting powers of states. So for that, we also would need approval from states. If more than 50% of states are approving, that means obviously it would not be a very bad thing for the states also. So only half of them are approving, more than half are approving. So like that, you can write for this also, that these are the situations or things where these can be made. So these were the questions. Any doubts on these parts?
No, ma'am.
So Mansi, is this enough or you need the answers also?
No, ma'am. The questions are enough, ma'am. We can like
enough,
frame
right?
Yes.
Yeah, you can frame it accordingly, like what all things you can write. Also, like you can refer to the notes also, like for like emergency only you can refer to the chart from where I taught you. So from that only you can mention the points. So mainly it depends on how, for how many marks this particular question is, accordingly you need to write. So what is the maximum marks for Karnataka judiciary? Any idea?
I have no idea. Prelims is for 100 marks.
No, like for one question, maximum marks.
Oh, that, I think constitution marks or like the split, I'll have to check.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So depending on that only, you can accordingly decide that how much time you have, how much you can write and all of that. So fine, a few more questions are there from that particular sheet that we will discuss in next class. And also with regard to cases, right? So see, while discussing different topics, we have already covered a lot of cases. So I have made a sheet with all those cases that we discussed in class. So that I will give you, and also some more cases here and there for different parts of constitution or different articles that also I will try to collect, and in next class we will discuss all those cases. Like whatever we have already discussed, that I will not do it again. I will just share the list, and also for the remaining ones we can discuss the cases. So these also were few cases. So whatever documents I have shared, you would see cases are always in this color highlighted. Constitutional amendments should always be in this color highlighted. So whatever topic you are reading, you can just go through the cases for that particular thing. So fine, then next class we will discuss the remaining questions and also the cases. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, ma'am. Thanks.